Joining us today on The Word Made Plain. If this is your first time viewing this broadcast today, please text FTG21 to 615-751-5495. Also, please like, share, and subscribe to our channel to be sure you receive future video notifications. Previously on The Word Made Plain.
It's only a part of it. Yes, we should study, but a fuller interpretation of the word that King James translation translated study is more like do your best. So the word study back in the 1600s was about being diligent, right? Striving, leaning in. So while studying, as we know studying, is part of that striving, part of that doing your best, part of being diligent, it's just not about reading. Reading is only a part of the relationship. Yes, we should read the Bible. Yes, we should study the Bible. But studying and reading is no substitute. They are not substitutes for the other responsibilities and duties of a believer. God wants to approve of what we have done, but if we only study and not apply what we have studied, it is all in vain. When we get to heaven and stand before judgment, God is not gonna have a game show like Jeopardy and ask us questions. No, it's not based on our knowledge, it's based on our presenting ourselves. Because the best way we can, because what? We have been diligent. We have made every effort. We have done all that.
Welcome to Olive Branch Church, where our mission is to create a vibrant community that emphasizes enrichment, excellence, and fellowship. We are so excited that you have tuned into The Word Made Plain with Pastor Dr. Vincent L. Windrow Sr. today. We hope that you're impacted, empowered, and enlightened through the Word of God. Let's join Pastor Windrow as he delivers today's message.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. This is the day that our Lord has made, and we have come to rejoice and be glad in it. It is Resurrection Sunday, and we have come to celebrate our risen Savior. We could not be more thrilled that you have decided to join us here at the Olive Branch Church in Nashville, Tennessee. And we want to kick off our celebration with one of our own from the Olive Branch Church Dance Ministry. Let us welcome Braylon Cook. Amen. Come on, put your hands together as we welcome Braylon. Lord, everybody.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Our God is truly holy. He is so holy that he didn't allow man to take his life. He laid it down. He laid it down because he loved us so, so much. And this is Resurrection Sunday. This is why we've come. We've come to worship him and to honor him and to give him the glory that is due his name. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. After everything that we have been through, we are still standing. After everything our eyes have seen and our ears have heard, we are still standing. We love you, Lord. We honor you, Lord. No matter what we see, no matter what we hear, no matter how we feel, the enemy meant it for evil. But oh God, you meant it for our good. And you keep blessing us, and you keep prospering us, and you keep moving us forward. And you got up. And that is proof that we too can get up. Amen. Amen. Come on, put your hands together for our risen Savior. He is worthy. This time has been set aside for us to still worship and to still give him glory and honor through our giving. Amen. It is time to give. The Bible says, ascribe to the Lord the glory that is due his name. Bring in your offering and come into his courts. And we know that when we come into the courts of the Lord, we come with praise and we come with thanksgiving. So when you give, give with a cheerful heart, a happy heart, knowing that we're giving back to a God who always gives to us and who gave us the gift that keeps on giving. Amen. We have various ways for you to offer your offering through our online, olivebranchchurch.org, through our Cash App, MyOBC, or you can even mail it in at 938 Haven Hill Drive, Nashville, Tennessee, 37219. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Our Lord, may these gifts truly represent our consecrations to your sacrifice and your service. As we are increasingly prospered, may we increase that which we return to you. In presenting our offering, O God, we also present ourselves. Through Christ, our risen Savior, let every heart say amen. Amen. Let us turn our attention, if you will, to today's announcements.
Welcome to Olive Branch Church, where our vision is to create a vibrant community that emphasizes enrichment, excellence, and fellowship. We are so excited that you are here today. Here are today's announcements. OBC sends a special birthday wish to all members celebrating their birthday this month. Have a happy, happy, happy birthday! It's time for our church-wide book drive. This year, we will study The Prayer of Jabez by Bruce Wilkinson. You can purchase this book wherever copies are available. Our first discussion of this lesson will take place on Wednesday, April 7th, during Bible study. Order your book today. Let's learn, let's grow together. Olive Branch Church will partner with the Black Community COVID-19 Response Team from Metro Public Health to provide vaccines for our family and community. The Pfizer vaccine will be administered at our Nashville location at 938 Haven Hill Drive, Nashville, Tennessee, 37217. The second dose will be given on Sunday, April 18th. For more information, email obcevents@olivebranchchurch.org. Come one, come all! The Young Adults Ministry, YGT, welcomes you to participate in our virtual seminar entitled Necessary Endings, led by Reverend Justin Lester, pastor of Congdon Street Baptist Church of Providence, Rhode Island, on April 15th from 7 to 8 p.m. via Zoom. Join us in a discussion about Jonah and making concrete decisions on our minds, bodies, and souls in order to pursue what God has for us. Remember, some things have to end in order for you to live. To RSVP, email youngadults@olivebranchchurch.org. See you there. Save the date for our 2021 virtual women's conference. That's right, May 13th through 15th, we will engage in a time of learning and growing together. This year's theme is Renew, Rebuild, Restore. Mark your calendars and stay tuned for more information. The OBC Ministerial Alliance invites all members to join them for Monday morning prayer on Monday, April 5th from 7 to 7:15 a.m. A church-wide texted message will be sent with the dial-in information. Do dinner with OBC. We will be serving 300 free hot meals for you and your family at our Murfreesboro location at 1115 Minerva Drive. No need to get out of the car. Just pull up to the curb and we will gladly serve you and your family. For more information regarding any of these announcements or to sign up for events, email us at churchatmen@olivebranchchurch.org or call us at 615-941-1268.
Come on, put your hands together and give God praise if you're thankful for the blood of Jesus.
From his hands, feet, and his side was more corrupt.
Glory to God. Come on, people of God, put your hands together and let us thank our wonderful God. He has blessed us in so many ways, and He has made it possible. Yes, He's made it possible for us to be here to celebrate our risen Savior. Amen. Please join me in prayer. God, we lift our hearts unto You. God, we lift our lives unto You. God, we lift this prayer unto You in the name of Jesus. God, You have brought us from a mighty long way. And if it had not been for You on our side, God, we would not be here today as part of this celebration. So, God, we thank You. God, we thank You for keeping us. We thank You for noticing us. God, we thank You for protecting us. God, we thank You for loving us as You have and as You do and as You will. God, our trust is well founded in You. God, we are counting on You for breakthroughs. We're counting on You for second chances. We're counting on You, God. And we believe because we're counting on You that You're going to come through even as You have done before. God, as is our routine call, we ask You, God, to open our ears that we would hear. Open our hearts, God, that we would feel. Open our eyes that we would behold the wonderful truths contained in Your word. That we would be better leaving this broadcast than when we first tuned in. Bless now the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart, that what might be said and done would be pleasing and acceptable in Your sight. I acknowledge that indeed You are my strength and my redeemer. In the name of Jesus, the risen Savior, we pray and we praise. Amen. Amen, people of God. I am so delighted that once again we are here at the Olive Branch Church. My name is Vincent Windrow. My title is senior pastor of this church, and my desire is that you have been blessed, you are blessed, and you'll be blessed forevermore. This is not just any old day. This is Sunday. This is the Lord's day, the most holiest of all days, as we congregate to celebrate a risen Savior. Isn't that something to be excited about? Isn't that something to be geeked about? Isn't that something to party about, that our Jesus, the Messiah, the one who was to come, has come and is to come again? He is not dead. He was dead, yes. Make no mistake about it. It wasn't a fairy tale. It wasn't something someone conjured up or imagined, but our Savior, He was dead. But right early Sunday morning, God raised Jesus from the dead. But church, what would have happened if Jesus had died but had not been raised from the dead? We would not be having this worship service. We would not be having this celebration. Oh, sure, we could have talked about how good of a man He was or good of a teacher He was. He was a master rabbi. All those instructions, all those parables, all that He taught, we could have considered Him to be the greatest teacher in the world. He was a miracle worker. Walked on water. We could go on and on and on and on about His miracles. But He was far more than a master rabbi, far more than a miracle worker, far more than a water walker. He is the resurrected Savior that separates Him from every wise man, that separates Him from every miracle worker, that separates Him from anyone who has ever walked this earth. Far more than just anybody else, He is the Lord. Paul wrote it like this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 14. And if Christ be not risen, our preaching, your faith would be in vain. It would be useless. But aren't you glad today? I'm talking about, aren't you glad today? You could have been glad last week. You could have been glad last month. You could have been glad last year. But on today, aren't you glad today that death could not hold Him down? That it was impossible for Him to become a prisoner of death? God raised the Lord Jesus Christ from among the dead. It's important that we recognize that Jesus was among the dead. David was among the dead. Solomon was among the dead. Moses was among the dead. Aaron was among the dead. But God raised the Lord Jesus Christ from among the dead. The God of hope, the God of grace, the God of Israel, the God of peace raised Jesus from among the dead. And so we are here in celebration mode because the Lord, he is risen. The one who was dead is dead no more. Come on, people of God, put those hands together. Let us thank our God. Let us thank him for raising Jesus from the dead with all power in heaven and in earth in his hands. Glory, glory to God. So happy Resurrection Sunday to you and to you and to you and to you. Amen. The Reverend Dr. Deborah Sellenhendrix has already presented our sermonic scripture for this Sunday morning's sermon and worship service. I'm just so very grateful that I got to see her again, and the music ministry was here with me this morning as we continue to focus on what's important. Have you ever caught yourself majoring in the minor things? Don't major in the minor things. Major in the major things. There's so much that can divide us, so much that can separate us. But let the Lord Jesus Christ and his death, burial, and resurrection be the thing that connects us, the glue that holds us together. Amen. So here it is. Lazarus is dead. Who is Lazarus? Lazarus, a brother to Mary and to Martha, and a friend, a dear friend to the Lord Jesus Christ. He's dead. And Jesus doesn't come immediately when he hears the news. He tarries. But now he has arrived on the scene. And he begins to console, inspire Martha, and he tells Martha, "Thy brother shall rise again." Now, Martha, peep this, Martha trusts the word of God. Martha knew the word of God, so she replies to Jesus, Yeah. I know he shall rise again in the resurrection of the last day. Martha was no stranger to the word of God. She knew the word of God. She knew of the resurrection in the last day. But Martha saw the resurrection as an event, as a happening, as something to occur. But the Lord Jesus Christ took that opening. He saw the opportunity to not just allow Martha to continue to believe that the resurrection was an event, but rather he presented to her that he was the resurrection. He said it himself, "I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the good shepherd." And here now he says, "I am the resurrection and the life." It was his declaration, his claim that he was the source of both the resurrection and life. He asserted, Jesus did, that the resurrection was not an event, but rather it was a person. It was him. Let me tell you this, brothers and sisters, that when you trust in God's word, it's an opportunity for you to be shown, for something to more to be revealed unto you. When you trust God's word, when you believe in God's word, there lies an opportunity for you to learn more. I told you before that God's word reveals and it conceals. We find out more about God. That's what we want, isn't it? We find out more about God when we trust in God's word. Martha trusted in God's word, and then she became the recipient, the beneficiary of this new revelation that Jesus Christ was the resurrection and the life. He continues in verse 26 by saying, "And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die." And then he poses this question, "Martha, believest thou this?" Can you get with what I just asserted, what I just declared, that whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die? The person that believes in me will live even if he dies. Do you believe that? Is that too far-fetched for you, Martha? Can you get with that? Can you handle that knowledge that though a person dies, yet if he believes in me, he shall live? People of God, I don't know if you know this or not, but in this world, at this very moment, there are millions of people who do not believe. Millions upon millions upon millions of people who do not believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus asks Martha, "Do you believe this?" Martha says, "Sure do. I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world." But if you ask the same question, if you pose the same question, if you have the same inquiry to millions upon millions of people, they do not believe. We don't know it. Why? Because we are believers. But there are more people today than ever who do not believe. But let me tell you this. Whether you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ or not, your disbelief does not disprove it. I don't care how much you disbelieve. I don't care how long you disbelieve. It doesn't matter why you disbelieve. The fact of the matter is, your disbelief doesn't disprove it. Don't you know that withholding your belief doesn't hurt God? Your withholding your belief doesn't diminish God. It doesn't discount God. God is going to still be God whether you believe it or not. Why? Because your disbelief doesn't disprove it. God is going to be God. Jesus is going to be the Savior of the world. The Holy Ghost is still going to be the Comforter. They are going to be them, one God. Why? Because our belief is not for God. Our belief is for ourselves. God is the Most High God. He's not brought lower because you don't believe. It doesn't change who he is. He's still the one who stepped to the mic and said, "Let there be light," and there was light. He is still the creator of the world. He is still the God of all the galaxies. Just because you withhold your belief does not disprove that God is God, and it doesn't disprove that Jesus is the light of the world. I don't care what you say, it doesn't diminish God. And it doesn't diminish what he did in sending the Lord Jesus Christ to earth. It doesn't. All it does is jeopardize our eternal living. Where shall we go when we die? If we're called upon to pack up our tent and leave this earth right now, where would we go? We'll mess around and squander the opportunity. Your disbelief in Jesus does not disprove him. He is still the one who was to come, has come, and is to come again. People of God, let me tell you this. Being wrong about right is a major failure. You fail big time when you're wrong about what's right. The consequence of being wrong about Jesus being the Savior of the world is eternal. There are eternal implications, not just momentary, not just temporary, but eternal, everlasting, forever. Being wrong about what's right about the Lord Jesus Christ is a major fail. Now listen, you can be wrong about who the greatest boxer is. You can be wrong about who the greatest quarterback is. You can be wrong about who the greatest basketball player is. You can be wrong about who the greatest R&B singer is, the greatest poet is, the greatest pastor is, but don't be wrong about Jesus. You can be wrong. You can have your opinion about all of that. People are still trying to pit Michael Jordan against LeBron James. Who is the GOAT? You can be wrong about that. But you better not be wrong about the Lord Jesus Christ. And so when the question is posed to you, do you believe that Jesus is the resurrection? Do you believe that Jesus is the life? Do you believe in him? Do you trust in him? Do you rely on him? Do you cling to him? Do you believe? I don't care what else you get wrong. Don't you get that wrong. He is the Savior. He is the risen Savior. He is the ascended Savior. And now sits at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for me and for you. Give God some praise for that. What a mighty God we serve. Touch your neighbor, say, neighbor, don't be wrong about this. Don't be wrong about this. You can have your opinion, but please, baby, please, don't be wrong about what's right, what's correct, and what the truth is about Jesus Christ. Believest thou this? Can you get with this? Can you rely upon this as truth? My Martha said, I'm with you now. I'm going to ride with you. You are the Christ. You are the Son of God. You are the one who was to come into the world. I don't know much about Martha. I don't know about her daily schedule. I don't know what her habits were. I don't know what her routine was. I don't know who she associated with in life. We only have a snapshot of who Martha is. Martha could have been a good person. I'm not taking anything away from Martha. I believe she was a good person. But being good, come on somebody, being good is not good enough. Martha could have been a good cook. Martha could have been a good friend. Martha could have been a good daughter. Martha could have been a good sibling. Martha could have been all of that. But being good is not good enough. Here's what people believe. People believe, really believe, that good people go to heaven simply because they're good people. Simply because they're good people, not because they believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. But many people believe that if you have high moral values, then you get into heaven. That's good that you feed the hungry. Do you clothe the naked? Good. Do you visit the sick? Good. Do you champion those who are marginalized? Do you lift up your voice for those who are downtrodden? All of that is good. Are you a good son? Are you a good father? Are you a good mother? Are you a good husband? Are you a good wife? Are you a good first cousin? Are you a good deacon? Are you a good usher? Are you a good greeter? Do you sing well in the music ministry? Do you play well? All of that is good, but good is not good enough. Good is not good enough. It's great that you're good and you do good things. It's great that you serve on nonprofit boards. It's good, but good, people of God, is not good enough. Being good does not get you into heaven, because all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We've fallen short of the standard of God, of the holiness of God, of the perfection of God. All of us, none of us are perfect. All of us are imperfect. So no matter how well we do in life, no matter the many good works that we do, we cannot be saved by works. We have been saved for works, for good works, but good works do not save us. You know John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish, but would have everlasting life. You must believe in him. You must cling to him. You must rely on him. You must try him. You must trust in him. You must be born again. Keep doing good stuff. The world needs bright spots. Keep doing the good that you do. But don't think that your good works will get you into heaven. Good that you do it, but good is not good enough. People of God, Jesus said it like this in John 14:6, no one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus is the way to salvation. We are saved by grace through faith. And that faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not in our works. It's not in our fraternities or sororities. It's not in our lodges. It's not in our positions, not in our vocations, not in our personalities, not in our careers, not in our titles. We are saved by grace through faith. Faith in who? Not faith in ourselves. Not faith in a denomination. Not faith in a pastor. Not faith in the church. But we are saved by grace through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. You must be. You got to be. It's not a might. It's not a maybe. It's not a perhaps. You must be born again. So here, people of God, on another Resurrection Sunday, we give God thanks and praise for delivering us, hearing our distresses, and delivering us from all of them, for keeping us. At the beginning of this service, the Reverend Dr. Deborah Sandlin said that we have felt so much over the last year. We've seen so much over the last year. We've hurt so much over the last year, and yet here we stand, and yet here we are, and yet we have survived. So give God glory if you're glad that he's still on your side. Come on, give God glory if you're glad that he's still in the blessing business. Come on, give God glory for being amazing and holy and righteous and true to his word. God is not a man that he should lie. He sticks to his promises and stands by his word. Amen. Resurrection Sunday is far more than just another date on the calendar, far more than just another Sunday. This is the time that we really hone in and focus in and emphasize that Jesus was dead, but he triumphed over death. He was victorious over death. And when God raised Jesus from the dead, I believe God raised us from the dead. Jesus' victory over death was our victory over death. How many Resurrection Sunday morning sermons have you heard? They all center around the same thing. But we need to hear over and over and over again that he died. And it wasn't a pretty death. Sometimes when we think about death, perhaps particularly our own, we see ourselves dying in our sleep, perhaps, with a smile on our faces. Peaceful. But Jesus didn't die that death. His death was an ugly death, a painful death. Glory to God. And yet, even knowing what he would face on Calvary's cross, on Golgotha's hill, Jesus still went on knowing what he would be confronted with, knowing the pain that he would have to endure, knowing the ridicule, knowing the disrespect, knowing the agony, knowing all that would transpire. And yet, he told his disciples, I got to go to Jerusalem to be tried by the chief priests and scribes. I've got to go through it, because the only way for you to be saved, the only way for you to be redeemed, is if I carry out my purpose as the Messiah. Glory to God. Died he did, raised he was, and we are not just the better for it. Glory to God. We have a right to the tree of life. We too can be among the great cloud of witnesses, bearing witness to the fact that faith is the victory. And without faith, it's impossible. It's impossible. Not just hard, not just difficult, not just challenging. It is impossible to please God. So on this Resurrection Sunday morning, 2021, I bear witness that Jesus Christ is Lord, that he is the Savior of the world, and that he is risen. Do you believe? Do you? I'm referring to you. I'm asking you. This is a personal question, and it begs an answer. Do you believe? Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you believe that the only way to the Father is through him, that he is the gate, he is the door? Do you believe? It's a simple question, but it has all of these eternal implications. Do you believe? If you don't know him in the saving of your souls, the forgiveness of your sins, and the enlightenment of your minds, give your hand to the preacher remotely, virtually, but give your heart to God. If you don't know where you would go, if this moment or the next moment or the next several moments were your last moments, if you don't know that you would go to heaven, would you do yourself an eternal favor? Would you repeat after me? Dear God, I am a sinner. And God, I have trespassed against your word. I have transgressed against what you want for humankind. But here today, God, right now, I open up my heart and I ask that the Lord Jesus Christ would come into my life, that I would be saved, and God, that you would accept me into your family. Amen. Perhaps you already know him as Lord and Savior and Master and Messiah, and you feel compelled, a strong urge by the Spirit of God to be added to this church. It doesn't matter how you come, but it does matter that you come. It matters that you don't allow stubbornness or disobedience or arrogance to stand in your way. He that hath ear, let him hear that Jesus Christ is not a way. Jesus Christ is not one of many ways. Jesus Christ is the way. If either of those two scenarios fit your situation, would you type, I choose OB to the number that now appears on your screen. I choose OB, run it all together, I-C-H-O-O-S-E-O-B, to the number that now appears on your screen. We want to engage you. We believe that we have been called upon by Almighty God himself to help walk you home, to be a blessing to your life, to draw the circle wide enough to include you, just like God, through the Lord Jesus Christ, drew the circle wide enough to include us. It was through Jesus that he reconciled all creation back unto himself. Amen. Glory to God. We give God thanks and praise for a wonderful opportunity to give him thanks and praise for all the many blessings that he has bestowed upon us, the blessings that have overtaken us, have overwhelmed us. Aren't you glad today that God is still the God of light, still the God of love, and still the God of life? Yes, he is, no matter where you are, no matter what you're facing. I want you to know that God is on your side, and if, since he is for you, he is more than the world against you. Glory to God. Not only is this the Lord's Day, not only is this Resurrection Sunday, but today is also First Sunday. Oh my. Not only do we get to celebrate a risen Savior, but we get to remember. Jesus says, as often as you do this, do this in remembrance of me. But what does it mean to remember? It means to pull back in your thoughts. It means that what you have perhaps allowed to leak out or get down in the deep recesses of your memory, he's saying, reel them back in. As you consider, recognize, and acknowledge, and hopefully appreciate the supreme sacrifice that the Lord Jesus Christ made, not just on your behalf, but in your place. We deserved eternal damnation. We were the ones in the Garden of Eden that turned our backs and walked away from God. But just like sin entered into the world through a man, so does redemption. So did salvation enter into the world through a man. Glory to God. You know the story. Communion is far more than a ritual, far more than something that Olive Branch Church hosts, celebrates on every first Sunday. It's our time to remember that we are in this thing together. Communion should strike you as something as important that we could not save ourselves. Glory to God. There was Jesus assembled with his disciples, and he took the bread. The King James translation says that he blessed it. A more literal translation suggests that he gave thanks for it. God We thank you for being so kind to us, for being so tender and sensitive to our needs. You knew that we needed a Savior. God, you knew that we could not save ourselves. So God, we thank you for including us in the body of Christ. For that and for so much more, we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. And Jesus, he took the bread. And he said, take, ye eat, for this is my body. Let us commune together. And Jesus, in the same manner that he gave thanks for the bread, he gave thanks for the contents of the cup. God, you saw us. There we were, on a roadside of life, not fitting to live and not fitting to die. But glory to your name, you Most High God. You sent your Son to shed his blood, to shed his innocent blood. And though our sins were like scarlet, God, Jesus' blood washed us. It made us white as snow. 2,000 years later, it's still washing, still cleansing. For that and for so much more, we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. And Jesus, he took the cup and said, take ye, drink, for this is my blood shed for the remission of your sins. Come, let us commune together. Amen. Glory to God. Brothers and sisters, children of the Most High God, I pray that your hearts were pricked on today. I pray that you would remember that it is through the sacrifice of the Lord that makes all of this possible. I pray that God would release you into this week with renewed vigor, with renewed vitality, and with a renewed commitment to proclaim the glorious gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, to be a friend to the friendless, and go about the good works that you were saved for, those works that God had preordained, that he had established for you. Amen. Once again, happy Resurrection Sunday. God, not unto ourselves, but unto you do we give thanks and praise and glory. God, you have done for us what we could not do for ourselves. God, you gave your only begotten Son because you loved us so much. Thank you, God, for modeling the behavior that we should follow. Anything that we love, we should give to. We should give up for. God, thank you for settling this word inside of us. The enemy does not want us to believe, God. The enemy does not want this word to be buried inside of us, God. But we pray, God, that you'll push it down inside of us, that at the right moment, in the right season, we'll be able to bring out what was brought in today. We give you thanks and the praise. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless, spotless before his throne with exceeding joy, to the only wise God be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Somebody say hallelujah. Somebody say thank you, Jesus. Everybody say amen. God be with you until we meet again.